Hi, I'm Mark Bryant and I'm here in Clitheroe tonight for Woho Music to talk to Dodgy.
Through the seasons I have journeyed, we fly the crew to where I'm bound. I've lost my bearings long ago. I watched that hero's come and go, and since then I've heard no sound. So let me go.
You, Nigel, Andy, collectively known as Dodgy, thank you for joining us.
Pleasure. Whatever, okay.
So how does your experience of touring these days compare with when you first started out doing it?
Well, we're not doing as many gigs as we used to do when we started out because we've been concentrating on recording an album, which we're doing at the moment. I mean, it's extensive, heavy touring in the back of a transit van. At the end of the day, it's a young man's game because it's, you need to be able to take the bruises and the late nights and everything. You know, and the tours that we do would be non-stop. You know, we'd do a 30-day tour of the UK, then we'd go out to Europe, then we'd come back, go into the studio, and then go on another tour. And that's really hard, and you need to be young and full of energy to do that. You know, as you get a little bit older, you know, you need to tour in luxury. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They do more. You know, plush.
Yeah.
I mean, look at these door handles. I mean, that's beautiful. We never used to have those kind of door handles when we were...
We'd be covered in graffiti, this room. Look at it now, like, you
exactly.
know.
Right, from Wikipedia, it defines one notable British band and artist with an identifiably Britpop sound who were active during the first wave of 1993 and 1997. Now, given all the other acts so labelled Britpop, how do you feel about the label? Is it a badge of honour?
We didn't like it. We never really liked it. I think, you know, it's kind of like, it was a name that, they tried so many names, but that was the one that stuck for the period. But when you look back on it, it's now 2010, and you look back on, it's 15 years ago, 16 years ago, and it's like some golden age of British music, and it's called Britpop. That's really original. Do you know what I mean? And it's just like, you know, and in the 60s it was the British invasion. Do you know what I mean? There's some, you know, it's like, we were just, I don't know. I have no opinion on it at all. I don't think about it.
We never thought we were part of any kind of scene. We only really heard about Britpop when we went abroad and we got interviewed by German guys. So what is a Britpop? And we're like, I don't know, what is it? and then they list a load of bands like Supergrass and the Charlatans and Pulp and Oasis. And we're like, well, we don't sound like them, do we? So, you know, you normally within a movement, bands kind of sound like each other. So it was something that was labelled. And it's a double, it's one of them kind of swords that's got two edges on it.
Yeah.
Kind of one of them swords that...
A double-edged sword?
No one likes a smart aleck. It's like a double-edged sword. On one side, it was really good, the fact that we were swept up in this movement. On the other side, you also get labelled with bands like Menswear, which is never good.
Do you all have a favourite Dodgy song or a favourite Dodgy album?
Favourite Dodgy song is the one we've just written.
Do you have a favourite child?
Yeah. So you see them all as your children, you
know? Yeah, I do, actually, yeah. I do. I see them all like, you know, there's some are less fortunate than others, but, you know, I'm not going to split hairs, you know what I mean?
They're You're all, talking about Molly?
You're talking about me songs.
Oh, I'm sorry.
you know. Yeah, I mean, I can't differentiate, you know. They all took time.
As I said, we're writing some cracking new ones, so it'll be on the new album. Absolutely cracking. As good as we've ever done. But we're also pulling out some old ones that we haven't done for a while. We're playing a song called Sylvia's Bedroom, which is the B-side of, God, a really,
the
really...
First single, 92.
And I think we're going to play that tonight. It's good to dust off stuff that you haven't done for a while, you know.
The song The Elephant kind of stands out from the rest of your stuff. How did that come about? It's so different.
Mm-hmm. Well, it came about...
Drugs again, wasn't it?
At the time... In 1991, was it? Elephant? 1990. Matthew's dad went travelling around India and he bought some tapes back and he went, yeah, I'll listen to this. And so, you know, they ended up in my room. Sorry about that. Yeah. And anyway, and I just went through them and just started sampling, and I sampled this tabla loop and it was in F and the song was written in F. And then the lyrics, that was the music background, and the lyrics were all about sort of being a bit messed up on... you know, on things, and sort of not knowing the clear way through, and not knowing what was going to happen next. And I think the insecurity that drugs can give you, you know, as well as the highs, the lows, you know, and I think all those sort of things really.
It was a good watermark for us, that song. We all really enjoyed that, and we got a lot of affection for it. Mm. A lot of people do love that. It got a great review in the NME as well, I remember. Great review. It said it had lots of Zeitgeist. Not sure what that means.
Lily Allen.
Yeah.
So, lots of artists have very different ways or means of writing the material. Is there anything in particular that inspires you guys to come up with songs?
Or? Our surroundings, really, I think. I think our what goes on around us, and that's become more clear as we've got older. I don't think we were in any fit state to actually work out what that whole thing was years ago. We used to write songs, but it was obviously about how we were and what was going on in our lives. And I think now it's just we understand it a little bit more, you know. So I'm really influenced by my area where I live, you know, sort of like the folklore, the history, the nature of what goes on around it, you know, and stuff like that, you know, and people I know as well. So people I've become, you know, past, who we cross, and I think, you know, worthy of a song, or it just pops into my head. So songs come from everywhere. Songs are just like, you know, if you had a bunch of postcards, you'd probably... Doesn't make sense, that one. I'm sorry.
Now, you've played gigs with a lot of bands, some of them from the Britpop era. Who have you been most impressed with, and is there anybody you're in actual awe of?
A band that we've played with that we're in awe of? We were on tour, a three-piece suite in 1996, and our manager rang up Harvey Goldsmith and said, we've got a day off in between Stoke and London, can we come and watch The Who in Manchester? And the message back was, only if you play? We went, all right then! And it was on their Quadrophenia tour, and as a result we played with The Who, which was incredible.
It was alright. Yeah. Joking, it's a joke. We tried.
Brilliant. So yeah,
so Nigel, you've done some solo work. What's it like to be back with the Dodgy again?
Crowded. Yeah.
We're doing one of his songs, actually.
Yeah, it's good. I like it. I prefer it. Must admit. Prefer it.
Good. It's nice to know, isn't it?
Sorry for asking that. I think.
I got stung the other day at 6:30 in the morning by a wasp my ass.
It was a gay wasp.
I put my jacket, my wife said, go up and make me a cup of tea. I was like, okay, didn't want any hassle. I don't know, been in bed about 3 hours. I put my shorts on without looking inside, walked, done about, but by the time I got downstairs, it was 6:30, and I was going, ah, like that. And there was a wasp actually on my pants, and it already stung me. I still got the jump. Do you want to see it?
Yeah!
Do you want to see
it? Yeah!
Do you?
So you're about to release your first album of original material in around about 10 years, I believe.
Well, actually, no. It's in 14 years since we've released 14. An album.
So by the time it comes out next year, it'll be a 15th year.
We're sort of recording it now, and we've just had some really good new songs coming through, and... we'll definitely have it finished by the end of the year, and for release in the new year. Don't know how we're going to release it, who we're going to release it through. Those are the details.
That's the trick, really. Anyway,
those are the details.
It's how to release a record these days.
Exactly. All that will come. The most important.
We're
going
to learn how to do that. Don't know how, but we're going to do it.
Most important thing are the songs.
Now, as a band, in the past, you haven't shied away from social issues, do you feel strongly that you should reflect certain social issues still?
Again, it's just what goes on around us, really. So if something goes on around us that we feel emotionally that it's wrong or it's an injustice, then, you know, say something about it, definitely. I don't think there's any problem with that.
Yeah, I mean, at the time we were, you know, we had quite a lot of popularity and we were, you know, a lot of kids would come to our gigs, and so we'd use that to be able to put certain issues across with the Dockers or whatever. You know, and if we get into that situation again where, you know, we think that we can do some good and we're very passionate about something, we'll do it, I guess.
Can I just come in here?
Yeah.
Right, weirdly, and I was thinking this when we were driving up, Dodgy have only released records when we've been under conservative rule. Because we're releasing our next record next time, and it's obviously this whole thing that people say, yeah, but when the Conservatives in, art gets better. That's, because there's more to kick against. Yeah. So there it's you true. Go, that's it. So we'd never released a record under Labour.
Yeah.
That was the reason why we didn't.
Yeah, that's right.
So is there a particular Dodgy record that you feel makes a particular political statement?
Oh, it's you always try not to make them very, very pointed and absolutely about something. You know, you want it to be a little bit more, you know, loose on the meaning, because you want to be able to people to put their own meanings into it as well.
But like
UKRIP. But UKRIP was specifically about the state of it, was about the state of England and the fact of.
And it's not united.
You know. Yeah, exactly. And it was very. It was almost like a kick against Britpop and all this false nationalism, you know, which I hate. I don't mind people feeling too patriotic, but if as a result of it you start being xenophobic against other nations, it's absolutely disgusting. So the difference between nationalism and patriotism, and UKRIP was about that, about all these people that had the Union Jack, you know, and being all sort of nationalistic, and we're saying, well, you know what, it's not united, you know, it's
no.
But you know, there's been other songs as well we've done over the years that you know have been very much motivated by a certain situation.
I think it's a really important bit, like I said, Steve. You know, it's like, who, you know, these people like if English Defence League, they were up north this week, and it's just like they just go places. They around here, are they?
I believe so.
Better, I'll keep you quiet. But you know, their whole point is that, like, you know, Britain should be clean and white, and it's just like Britain's never been that. So what are they going on about? You know, people like, what is his name from the BNP? I agree. Nick Griffin. You let him have TV space because he's an idiot. And the more he gets on TV, the more people can realise what an idiot he is and what idiotic ideas he's got, the better, really. Do you know what I mean? Because it's, you know, there's no time for that, really. You know, there's no time for that sort of intolerance and ignorance anymore.
So are you happy with the way the album recording's gone?
Yeah. Fantastic. Amazing. I've just had a really good idea, actually. Why don't we release it on a new format? You can only buy, and we have the player as well, so you can only buy the player and the record from us.
I mean, on my back.
So like some sort of weird record shape thing, but you can buy it, maybe, and it'll only play on a dodgy stereo.
So people have to buy the software from us,
exactly,
the hardware from us. And then they buy
the key. They buy a key from us. They plug it in and they go, I've got my key.
Dongle,
I can now listen to the dodgy dongle.
That's it. But in the shape of a wasp.
Yeah, not the wasp. But that's a good idea, isn't it? There you go.
Yeah, absolutely.
There you go.
We hit a bong.
Sorted it just now. Brilliant.
Do you reckon you can get some odorators for Crocs?
Oh.